drew near to Bethphage in Bethany, in the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' you should say this: 'The Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went away and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus upon it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. As he was drawing near, already on the way down to the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To you from Luke chapter 19, 41 to 44. This is a continuation of what we just heard. When Jesus drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "Would that even you had known on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children within you. They will not leave one stone upon another in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation." The grass withers and the flower fades. The word of our God stands forever. Let me pray. Father, I ask that for all that I say and do brings glory to you. Nothing that I would say, nothing I would do, nothing I've left unsaid or undone would hinder the work of your Spirit. We ask this in the name of Jesus. A few weeks ago, I went to see a movie with my son, Thatcher, my youngest son. Thatcher is kind of the history buff in our family. Years ago, he really got into the Titanic and learned just about anything about the Titanic you could want to know, and then some. And then he sort of got into military history, so he's sort of dabbling in that. And, you know, this is about 100 years since the end of World War I, and so mostly 20th century kind of military history is his thing. So a few weeks ago, the movie 1917 came out. So we went to see that movie together. It's a movie based on stories that the director, a man named Sam Mendes, heard from his grandfather, who was in World War I. He told him these stories, and those stories captured his imagination. And so he put together this movie, the story, and it's it won Best Film, Golden Globe, not that long ago. It's one continuous shot, this movie is. It's not a typical gory sort of war movie. It's the story that sort of draws you in. It's very compelling. And so the story itself takes place on April 6, 1917, which is a significant day because that is the day that the United States actually entered World War I. So my son and I watched that movie together. And after we left the theater, we were talking about the movie and talking about World War I, and he got more information for me than he wanted. I mean, as a 14-year-old, he's like, "Dear Lord, will you ever stop talking? Dear Father," but I just kept talking. We started talking about things that came out of World War I. Have you all ever seen trench art? If you do a Google search, you can find where, you know, a lot of the soldiers would spend hours and hours and days in those trenches, and they would basically take some of the empty shells and they would carve into them, and they're beautiful, intricate works of art. And you can go buy some of these spent shells, brass casings, that they have etched things in with their knives and created these beautiful vases and things like that. It's trench art. But there's also tons of poetry that came out of World War I, mostly from the British. Amazing poetry that emerged from these trenches, these poets like Wilfred Owen and Rupert Burke, Siegfried Sassoon, these poets, some of who wrote great poetry and then ended up dying in battle not long thereafter. So there's a lot of that. But at the same time, after America entered the World War, the war ended in 1919, and we had a huge parade. We talked about that a little bit, that we had this celebration. In fact, Black Jack Pershing led 25,000 American troops in full battle regalia down the streets of Washington, D.C., and then in New York City. And all these people celebrated this victory parade. And that really sort of kicked off this time in the 20th century of all these parades, these military parades in the United States. We had the first one, the largest one basically, was after the Civil War, 1865, 140 some odd thousand soldiers marched through Washington, D.C., and all these people came and watched that parade. But the next one wasn't until 1919. It was after World War I, and all these people showed up, of course, to see this victory parade. But throughout the 20th century, there were a number of military parades. Sometimes they were victory parades, like, you know, the iconic one that we think of after World War II, the ticker tape parades. You know, you remember that picture of the sailor kissing the woman in the street. All that ticker tape coming down in New York City and troops marching down the street, both Washington and New York City, just these great parades. But we haven't seen a whole lot. But there's also been times throughout the 20th century in particular that there were parades, military parades and victory parades and shows of strength associated with inaugurations. FDR's third inauguration was a military parade, complete with, great show of force. And that was in 1941. And so people understood later on that that was a sign of strength, and it was an indicator, a foreshadowing of the war that was to come. A few years later was the great victory parade that I just mentioned. Eisenhower, when he was elected, did the same sort of thing. People commented because suddenly there were tanks rolling down the streets of Washington, D.C. that was a part of his inauguration. It unnerved some people to see that so close on the heels of the Second World War. Kennedy did the same thing. Some of you may remember Kennedy's inauguration. At his inauguration, there was this great sign of military strength that went down the streets of Washington, D.C. In fact, there was a missile in that parade, and that was important because given the fact that we had the Cuba Missile Crisis, we had the Cold War kind of the heart of that. There was this sign of strength along with this inauguration of our president. The last parade, military parade that we've had in the United States was actually in 1991. And it was the act celebrating the victory in the Persian Gulf. 8,000 troops marched in Washington, D.C., and marched in New York. And so it's kind of been this thing, it's been a while in our country that we've seen sort of one of those kind of parades. I know that's been, you know, in the press a little bit, but it's intriguing to think about that on the heels, especially in the 20th century, it happened with some regularity. But the thing is, though, it didn't begin with us. As exceptional as we are as Americans, we did not come up with the military parade. You can go through the annals of history and discover over and over these grand parades that would occur whenever a king or a general would conquer some land or some kingdom. And he would go into the capital city. From Alexander the Great to the Caesars, all through history, the Romans and the Spartans and the Greeks, there was this grand procession of all of it. And even with Jesus, we may not realize it, but the text we just read actually follows a pattern. Historians will tell you that that there are four things, that when a king or a general would enter a city and conquer the city in order to take power or take control of the city or take the throne, there were four shared characteristics. And what's fascinating is Luke tells us that Jesus followed these four patterns, except for the last one. The last one is very different, and very, very different, and actually quite disconcerting. And I'll tell you what the four of them are. According to historians, when a king or a general, a conqueror, would come in and take control of a city, one of the things that always occurred is that the king or the general was escorted by his army or by the citizens. And in the text that we just read, it's clear that the disciples are there, and there's this massive crowd around Jesus as he's beginning his entry into Jerusalem. Most of the time when we read this text in Luke's gospel, the Jesus' entry in Jerusalem, it's associated with Palm Sunday. And that's appropriate. But we're going to talk about it as a part of our study of Luke. And then in a few weeks, we'll talk about it again, and you guys will have some foundation, right? Some understanding. So the first thing we know is that when a king or a general would enter a city, he's going to take control of that city, or he's going to become, you know, king over to take the throne, is he would have an entourage with him. His army would be the citizens that would be with him. In Jesus' case, we have this massive crowd that is with him. His disciples are there. So that's the first thing. The second thing is this crowd or this army or all these people would be singing. There would be shouts of acclamation. There would be praises. There would be short songs. There would be all that. And we know that that's what happens when Jesus comes into Jerusalem, this triumphal entry. In fact, Luke doesn't give us the descriptions that the other gospel writers do, but he tells us that they're singing, that they're shouting. But we know from the other gospel accounts that they're singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You know, they're shouting this great acclamation of praise, and they're waving palm branches, right? We know that from the other gospel accounts. And so on Palm Sunday, when we'll talk about this text maybe again, all over the place, all over churches, all over the place, we'll have people that will reenact that. Sometimes it's children, sometimes it's other people. I guarantee that this church has done that in its history. We've had children or people with palm branches. When I was at serving a church in Charlottesville, I got a panicked call from my children's director because the Saturday before Palm Sunday, the florist basically told her, something's happened. The truck with all the palm branches didn't make it. They had an accident or something, and so they were going to deliver them that day. So she calls me, what are we going to do? And I was like, I have no idea. But I think our folks will understand that some, you know, tractor trailer. But she was able to find out how she found them. But that's a thing that we do, right? Hosanna, Hosanna. That's what's happening in our text. That's going on. There's a third thing. Somewhere during this procession, the ruler, the authority of the ruler is made clear. The authority of the ruler is made clear. That's one of the three things that happens, right? Well, here it is in our story. One of the things we're told is that he sends two of his disciples to go get a donkey, to go get this foal, this colt of a donkey that no one has ever sat on. And they go and they do exactly what he says, and that's his establishment of authority. And there's another little wrinkle in this story, too, that you may or may not know. Do you know what it means? Do you know why Jesus is coming in on a donkey? It was understood, this is highly symbolic, that when a conqueror came into a city, when a king or a general came into a city, people looked to see what he was riding. If he was riding a war horse, he was coming in war. If he was riding a donkey, he was coming in peace. It was highly symbolic. His authority is being established in just this action of bringing in this donkey. But not only that, as Jesus comes into the city, people are throwing their cloaks down. They're throwing things on the ground. And it's a sign of submission. And they're shouting out to Jesus, and they're raising his authority. And when the Pharisees asked, hey, let your disciples do this. Tell them to be quiet. Jesus reestablishes his authority, and he says, if they don't shout out, the very stones will cry out. Isn't that awesome? Three things Jesus is following this pattern. Three things. The crowd is with him. They're shouting acclamation because authority is established. They're following this awesome pattern that you can see as a conqueror is coming in, as a king is coming to take hold of the city. But the fourth thing, this is where things get really interesting. When a king or a general would enter the city, to take the city and take control of the throne, they would go to the temple, wherever it was. They would go to the citadel, they would go to the temple, place of worship. Usually it was accompanied by sacrifices, or they would do something. The Romans actually desecrated the temple in Jerusalem, but they would show there was something would happen at the temple. But Jesus does something incredibly different here. Incredibly different. And it's really powerful and troubling. Verse 41, we read this. When Jesus drew near and saw the city, he wept over it. It's quite a bit different than any other conquering king or general. When Jesus comes into the city, before he even makes it to the temple, he weeps over the city of Jerusalem. When he finally gets to the temple, we'll look at this in the coming weeks, he goes into the temple and he turns over the money changers' table and he drives them out, right? So he's still on his way to the temple, but here, before he even gets there, he weeps over the city. We often think of Jesus weeping over Lazarus, but here he tells us in Luke that he wept over the city. Can you imagine Winston Churchill or FDR or Eisenhower or Patton weeping over Berlin? Can't either. Or Caesar or Alexander the Great. But here, Jesus is coming into the city to lay claim to it and his authority over it, and he weeps. Everyone else is singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, they're cheering, they're shouting, and he's weeping. Why? What's happening? Why is Jesus weeping, and what does it say to us? Well, in verse 42 through 44, we get a little bit of an understanding of why he's weeping. Jesus says in verse 42, would that you, even you, and known on this day the things that make for peace, make for shalom, and now they are hidden from your eyes. You notice in this text in 44 that Jesus mentions the word peace, shalom. Remember how he entered the city? What was he riding? Foal of a donkey, colt. What did it mean? It meant he was coming to peace. Remember what Isaiah said about the Messiah when he came? He would be the Prince of Peace. Peace is a complex theme in the Bible. Shalom is a complex theme. It's far more complex than the notion of absence of conflict or arguments or whatever. No one in this room has lived through an extended period of peace. None of us have. The 20th century was full of conflict. There were very few years where the United States wasn't involved in some kind of conflict. Gearing up from it, either there were small skirmishes or all-out conflict. I mean, my children, all three of my boys, had never lived at a time when the United States was not embroiled in some sort of conflict somewhere in the world. My oldest will be 21 next week. From Gulf War to 9/11, for us to even begin to imagine what it means to live without conflict in our world, let alone in our own lives, it's a difficult concept. In the Bible, the idea of peace there always has to be linked to this word shalom. It always needs to be there. We have to link that understanding. When you read it in the New Testament, you should insert the word shalom every chance you get. Nick Walterstorff is a professor, he's a philosophical theologian. I got to know a little bit when I lived in Charlottesville, Virginia, who gave great shape to my own understanding of what it means to be Christian. He talks about shalom, and he defines it like this idea that Jesus is talking about, but he's trying to bring to the city of Jerusalem. He said, in shalom, each person enjoys justice, enjoys his or her rights. Shalom is the human being dwelling at peace in all of his or her relationships with God, with self, with fellows, with nature. Shalom is not merely the absence of hostility, not merely being in right relationship. Shalom at its highest is enjoyment in one's relationships. A nation may be at peace with all its neighbors and yet be miserable in its poverty. To dwell in shalom is to enjoy living before God, to enjoy living in one's physical surroundings, to enjoy living with one's fellows, to enjoy life with oneself. Shalom, in the first place, incorporates right, harmonious relationships to God and delight in his service. Shalom is perfected when humanity acknowledges that in its service of God is true delight. Shalom incorporates right, harmonious relationships to other human beings and delight in human community. Shalom is absent when a society is a collection of individuals all out to make their own way in the world. And of course, there can be delight in community only when justice reigns, only when human beings no longer oppress one another. In shalom, love and fidelity now meet, justice and peace now embrace. That's the idea of shalom, of peace that is woven all the way through the Bible. It's not just this absence of hostility. It's human beings living in a right relationship with God, with each other, with themselves, with all of creation, and being concerned about the needs of one another, flourishing, the enjoyment of one another, and working towards that end. Now, why bring that up? Well, Jesus weeps for Jerusalem because he had come to bring shalom to God's people, to people who should have been anticipating it, waiting for it, longing for it. But more than that, they should have been living it out and working for shalom. That's why God called Abraham out of the Ur of Chaldees, that he would have a people that were a witness for him to the world, not just in the way they worshiped, but in the way that they lived in community with one another and the way they developed their community. We are Presbyterians. I think at times that we forget exactly why that has any sort of historical significance or anything else. But being Presbyterian means we're part of a Reformed tradition. And that Reformed tradition is anchored historically in particular people, one of which was John Calvin. Now, very often, people misunderstand who Calvin is and was, and they sort of anchor down on this whole bit about predestination, and that's as far as they get. They fail to realize that one of the things that Calvin did was he helped to really design the way that the church is to function. And actually, in Geneva, the city actually worked out of this design, his understanding of the way that the Christian community is to work. That's an important thing for us to consider, because our own government, to some extent, is based on this Presbyterian form of government, built on Calvin's idea. One theologian unpacked how Calvin understood what it means to live out the mission of shalom, because that's what it's anchored in, and this idea that Jesus is ushering in this idea of peace. And this is what he said. The answer to this question lies in the Calvinist understanding of the goal of God's redemptive activity. If we had lived as God meant us to live, we would all be members of an ordered community, bound together by love for each other and gratitude to God, using the earth for our benefit and delight. In fact, we do not live thus. A fall has occurred. God's response to this fall of mankind was to choose for all humanity a people destined for eternal life. They, in obedient gratitude, are now to work for the renewal of human life so that it may become what God meant it to be. They are to struggle to establish a holy commonwealth here on earth. Of course, it is the mandate of all humanity to struggle towards such a community. What makes Christians different in their action is that they have, in fact, committed themselves to struggling toward this goal. present as God's mandate, and that they struggle toward it not as just in obedience to God the Creator, but in imitation of Christ. It is because Christians are committed in obedient gratitude to work for the renewal of the earthly community that they will render their obedience in such ordinary earthly occupations as a tailor, a merchant, a farmer, and everything else. In other words, the call of the Christian community is to work for shalom just as Jesus did, just as Jesus continues to do through God's people. And that's what God's expectations were from his people from the very beginning, that we would bear witness to this mission of shalom, what he had intended. And that's why he called Abraham out and established this community. But over time, God's people throughout the Old Testament, if you read through it, you'll see that they wandered away from that. Oh, they worshiped. But God was turned off by their worship because their worship was just them going through the motions. Their community wasn't built on this notion of peace, of shalom, the way God had intended it. But over time, God sent different reminders, different peoples, prophets, and even outside pagan armies to bring them back to their senses. And sometimes they did for a season, and sometimes they didn't. And now we come to our text when Jesus himself, Jesus the King, comes into Jerusalem in order to bring shalom to the city. And when he does, he weeps because God's people are not living out of shalom and they fail to recognize God's purposeful saving activity on their behalf. God is sending his son, his king, into the world to bring peace, to bring shalom. And they can't see it. They reject it outright. They should have been ready. And so when Jesus gets there, he anticipates his own rejection and he weeps. And as he weeps, he uses a military language, images of military conquest. And unlike kings and generals entering the city to lay claim to it, Jesus goes Old Testament style prophet, and he begins to tell them what they can expect. And he says, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children within you. And they will not leave one stone upon a stone in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation. Friends, what Jesus is saying here should have terrified the people to no end, because there are images that harken back to this time in the Old Testament when Nebuchadnezzar came through, the Babylonians came through, and they tore down the temple and everything else, and they had to rebuild. The Jerusalem even then failed to recognize what was happening, and now it's failing once again to recognize Jesus as a part of God's visitation. And Luke is telling them what's happening as Jesus speaks these words. And you know what? It happened just as Jesus said it. In AD 66, there were some Jewish zealots that led a revolt against the Romans. Now, over time, there have been these small skirmishes of zealots throughout the years who pushed back on Roman occupation, but this was an all-out, full-blown revolt. And the Romans did not take kindly to it. And so Titus was actually sent into Jerusalem, and he wiped it out. I mean, wiped it out. Under Caesar's orders, Titus leveled the city of Jerusalem. They built barricades around the fortifications of the city, just as Jesus said they would. And they literally choked the life out of that city. A famine moved through the city of Jerusalem, and the atrocities are more than we can bear to think of. Children were killed for their food. It's horrible. After it was all over, Titus said, God indeed has been with us in this war. God it was who brought down these strongholds. He's given a nod to the divine, because the strongholds were so thick and so solid that only God could have helped them to overcome the city. They had rejected the king. Jesus' prophetic message is not a happy one. It's not vindictive. It's full of sorrow as he mourns the fate of the city. Jesus came then, and he comes now to bring peace, shalom. And this message of shalom is one of salvation. It's the gift of God that embraces salvation for all, that we can enjoy life and enjoy one another, enjoy God's creation, and have the fullness sense of all that it means to be alive. And we are to work for that. That's God's mission in the world. And Jesus brings brings it in the world, but there are people who reject it. The city that Jesus is talking and weeping over rejected Jesus as king. And Jesus anticipates his rejection even before he enters the city itself. And thus, as they reject Jesus the king, they refuse this sense of peace, this divine visitation. And now, they have judgment. We don't like to talk about that. We don't like to think about it. But that's tied to the rejection of Jesus as he brings peace and shalom. And for Jerusalem, they reach the point of no return. And what does all that have to do with us? Two things, at least. First is this. First is that we are marked by people who are on mission. We are to be the people who are on mission of shalom. That's our task in the world. If God's mission in the world is the mission of shalom, then it stands to reason that it should be our mission as well. And that means that we should be working as he is working. The second is this. Look at Jesus here and recognize that he wept for a people who were destined for judgment. He doesn't mock them. He doesn't soften the truth. He doesn't compromise the truth. He tells them where they're headed and what's coming. He does so with compassion, and grace, and mercy. He wept for the city. As one theologian put it, the wonder and joy of God's redemptive works are also accompanied by lament for those who will not respond to God's declaration of salvation. There's judgment waiting for those who reject Christ. We must remember that as we encounter others who may reject Christ, that we maybe weep for them and weep for our city too, knowing what awaits. But all the while, we are to bear witness and work for the renewal of humanity. We are on the mission of shalom. And in that, we bear witness to the gospel. Let's bear that in mind as we prepare our hearts to the table. Let me pray. God, our Father, we ask that you be with us as we participate, as we partake of this meal that you set before us, as a way of establishing that we belong to you. We ask, Lord, that you bless this cup, that you bless this bread, as we once again reaffirm our faith and trust in you. We ask, Lord, that you be with us. And Father, we ask that you be with those among us who are carrying heavy loads, those who are concerned about others, those who are looking to you for help. Father, we lift up our church to you. We pray for wisdom as we enter this new relationship with a new church. We ask, Lord, that you bless them as they reach people with the gospel as well. We pray for Jack and Evelyn Bales. We pray for Inez Duncan, for Edith Gibson, Bob Webb, Geneva Welch. We pray, Father, for others that are heavy on our hearts even at this moment. We ask that you be with them. Be with us as we look to you for all things and help us to bear witness to the gospel. We ask all this in the powerful name of Jesus, who called us to pray, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, let me remind you that this is the Lord's table. It's not a Presbyterian table. It's not Bethel's table. It's the Lord's table. And as such, it belongs to any of those who have made a profession of faith, put their trust in the Lord Jesus, and have made that public. Come to this table as those who have put our faith in him. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, saying, This is my body, broken for you, for the forgiveness of sins. And in the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. For every time you eat this bread, his cup, and proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Hallelujah. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us feed on Christ in our hearts with thanksgiving and drink, remembering that Christ's blood was shed for you. Please come forward.